Take your seats. We are about to begin session. The Legacy of Sherazad, Women and Fiction. Speakers, Shandana Minhas, Reshma K. Bashikar, and Meera Sethi. Moderator, Framji Minwala. Dr. Framji Minwala is currently the chairman of the Department of Social Science and Liberal Arts at the Institute of Business Administration, Karachi. His research interests include performance literature and history, visual and cultural. And politics. Ramji Minwala.
Can you hear me now? Excellent. Good afternoon. I'd like to introduce my panelists briefly. Meera Sethi is a Lahore-based journalist and actor. She has worked as a book editor at the Wall Street Journal before moving back to Pakistan in 2011. She has written for the Wall Street Journal, the New York Times, the New Republic, and various other international publications. Alongside acting in Pakistani drama serials, Meera is working on a collection of short stories. When will it be out?
I have no idea. It could be a year, it could be 2 years.
Okay. Reshma Barshikal is an Indian travel writer and novelist. She is also an erstwhile investment banker who, as she tells it, fell down the rabbit hole and discovered a world outside of fluorescent cubicles. As a travel writer, she contributes to India Today, Travel Plus, Silver Chris, Harper's Bazaar, Grazia, National Geographic, Traveler, and The Hindu. She is also co-founder of the literary blog, The Caterpillar Cafe, which is a wonderful blog. You should read it. Fade Into Red is her debut novel from Random House. It had a book launch yesterday. Reshma divides her time between Mumbai and the Nilgiris. And Shandana Minhas is a Pakistani English language novelist. Her first novel, Tunnel Vision, was shortlisted for the Commonwealth Writers' Prize in 2008. Her second book, Survival Tips for Lunatics, was published last October and on Friday won the Fiction Prize, KLF Embassy of France Fiction Prize. Congratulations. Her fiction has appeared in the Indian Quarterly and been adapted for stage and screen. Her columns and essays have appeared in assorted op-ed pages and online. She was a writer in residence at the University of Iowa's International Writing Program in 2013. Shandana is currently working on another novel and a short story collection. I thought I would begin by talking about the two halves of the title, The Legacy of Scheherazade and Women in Fiction. The Legacy of Scheherazade, I'm certain the story everybody knows, the story of the Arabian Nights, the story of the wife of King Scheherazade, who told him a story every night in order to avoid being killed the very next morning. What she would do was actually tell half a story and not complete it, and the seductive quality of the story would allow him, or he allowed her to live for one extra day so that she could complete the story. The next day she would begin another story, not complete it again. He would allow her to live again. And this continued for a thousand and one nights, a thousand stories, at the end of which he discovered he had fallen in love with her and allowed her to live and made her his queen. The title Women in Fiction actually comes from the subject of a talk that was given by given to Virginia Woolf in 1928. The subject of the talk eventually became Virginia Woolf's really important essay/book, A Room of One's Own. And I would actually like to begin by reading the beginning of her essay, which in some ways frames some of the issues that we would like to address today. When you asked me to speak about women in fiction, I sat down on the banks of a river and began to wonder what the words meant. They might mean simply a few remarks about Fanny Burney, a few more about Jane Austen, a tribute to the Brontes and a sketch of Howth Parsonage under snow, some witticisms if possible about Miss Mitford, a respectful allusion to George Eliot, a reference to Mrs. Gaskill, and one would have done. But at second sight, the words seem not so simple. The title Women in Fiction might mean, and you might may have meant it to mean, women and what they are like, or it might mean women and the fiction that they write, or it might mean women and the fiction that is written about them, or it might mean that somehow all three are inextricably mixed together and you want me to consider them in that light. But when I began to consider the subject in the last way, which seemed the most interesting, I soon saw that it had one fatal drawback. I should never be able to come to a connection. I should never be able to fulfill what is, as I understand, the first duty of a lecturer, to hand you, after an hour's discourse, a nugget of pure truth wrapped up between the pages of your notebooks and kept on the mantelpiece forever. So, in the hope that we might be able to provide you with a nugget of pure truth at the end of this hour, I turn it over to my panelists. What does women and fiction mean to you? We start perhaps with Chandana at the end.
Quite honestly, women and fiction means nothing to me. Fiction means something to me. Being a woman means something to me. But I do not know that they have to overlap.
Okay. Reshma?
Hello? Okay, it's on. I think that, and I to some extent agree with Chandana because I think that the author should not be part of the reading process. I think you write something and then you put it out there and you should step away from it and it's a story that you're telling someone. However, the voice of the writers always comes through and so there is that element of does the voice change when it's a woman or whether it's a man? It's okay. And I think that lately, especially because I am considered a chick lit writer, we've had a lot of talk in India about Anuja Chauhan's books, etc., and primarily the difference between Sophie Kinsella and Nick Hornby or Jonathan Troper, who wrote This Is Where I Leave You Now. And I was reading Jonathan Troper's This Is Where I Leave You Now the other day, and I said to my husband, I said, if this had been written by a woman, it would be called chick lit and wouldn't get a blurb from the Washington Post. But there's a use of profanity. Does that make that more real? So perhaps is it our writing style that gives us away that we are called by a different name? So I think that while I agree that shouldn't exist, I think it seeps in later on and therefore kind of pigeonholes you into the kind of fiction you write.
Okay.
Can you hear me? Loud enough? Okay. It's a really interesting question because, you know, if you look at the history of the novel was born in the late 18th century in England after the Industrial Revolution, which had created a middle class that was hungry to know what was happening in their neighbors' homes, what they were having for tea, who they were marrying, what was going on in this small, you know, provincial towns in England. At that time, in the late 18th century, at least for about 50 or 60 years, men predominantly wrote fiction, right? So men went out to sea, to fight wars. Men participated in politics. So that realm was occupied by men, and in that sense, they had a much vaster thing to draw from. So women's fiction, when it did arrive on the scene, as it did with the Bronte sisters and George Eliot, and then across the Atlantic, then there was Edith Wharton writing in the early 20th also. So there was this interest in, so there are women writing now, Jane Austen was writing in England. What are these women writing about? So that question, I think it's a very natural question, but at the end of the day, as Chandana said and as Reshma said, that category, we shouldn't pay too much attention to the category because there's either good writing or bad writing. Right? There's not writing by men or women. So there's good writing or bad writing. But the preoccupation with the idea that women tend to write certain types of fictions is an interesting one.
Sunam?
I was going to say that women's fiction began really the first time a man said to his wife or his maid, "What's wrong?" And she said, "Nothing." So to tie it necessarily to a form like the novel, I think I agree with you, but I think we have to go back a lot further than that. But I do think, Framji, that there is a depth to your question which doesn't necessarily have to do with storytelling itself, but with gatekeeping and distribution.
Can you elaborate on that a little bit?
Well, I think that women are the original storytellers. We kind of have to be. I think that we have been discriminated against in terms of distribution and in terms of publishing. But that is separate from the value of the stories we tell or the worth of the stories we tell.
Would you say, yeah?
I think that's right, because if you're looking at the legacy of Shehrazad, it is a fictional story compiled by a bunch of men. They chose a woman to tell these stories of, and they chose a woman who has to risk her life every day to spare the life of other women. So he was basically going to keep killing, and she went up to her father and she says, choose me, put me forward, and I will keep him entertained so that this barbaric thing comes to an end. But this is not a true story, and these are fairy tales, and men chose to use a woman to portray them. And as Shehrazad said, because we are the original storytellers, we're the ones who put the children to bed at night, we sing them to sleep. But why did they choose a woman? Because the stories themselves, when you read them as you go along, does the voice change? And voice, I think, plays a predominant role in whether it's a man or a woman. And I don't think it does, and it shouldn't. But is it changing? And I don't know why they chose, but they chose a woman because she's a natural storyteller.
I agree. I mean, you know, women are wives, their daughters, their sisters, their career-minded people. They have to juggle all these different roles. And I think in that juggling of these different roles, you're constantly sort of thinking about your life. And, you know, there's this inwardness, I think, that women nurture that men necessarily don't have, because we multitask all the time. And in that multitasking, there's a lot of tension, as they say in Pakistan, you know, which leads to the creation of stories. But going back to what Shandana was saying, completely agree about the nature of the publishing world and about distribution. The majority of book reviews done in, say, the United States of America, 70% written by men. So it's very skewed. If you look at the covers of books, you know, the big names in American fiction, Jeffrey Eugenides, John Updike, ab to hayat nahi hai, lekin jab the, Jonathan Franzen, all these people, they have, their covers usually have text on them, right? So it's serious, it's cerebral. There are very few women, Zadie Smith being an exception in Britain, whose novels have the privilege of having text and not an image. If you look at the covers of women's fiction, kya dekhenge aap? There'll be two deserted shoes on a beach, right? You'll see a woman's sexy bare back, right? You'll see a field of daisies. Because they want to, these covers appeal to women who, interestingly enough, are the majority of fiction readers. 70% of readers of fiction are women. And yet, to think that 70% of book reviews, so the people who make opinion, say in America, are men. So there's this bias, as Shandana was saying, against females.
And that's exactly why we get pigeonholed into the kind of, and when I had my book, when I was discussing my book cover, I wanted a photograph, a black and white photograph, because that's what I imagined when I was writing the book, with lots of red, because it's called Fade Into Red. And she turned around and she said to me, no, it needs to be colorful. It needs to appeal to a certain market. And I said, but why? And then as we went along, I started feeling the same amount of, from the review perspective, who do I get reviewed? And then the next day I see the same love stories written by men. Absolutely, getting much more coverage. But then again, we start politicizing again the whole women and fiction, and we start making excuses for ourselves. But really, we've come a long way. Hilary Mantel won the Booker twice, and she's a phenomenal writer. And I want to go back to voice, because when you read Hilary Mantel now, I don't know if it's a man or a woman. I know that it's a story that she says about a protagonist called Thomas Cromwell, and she brings Cromwell to life. It shouldn't matter if it's a man or a woman who's writing that.
But, sorry to interrupt you, but just to complicate that and to take it further, when a man writes about marriage, and he writes intelligently and sensitively about marriage,
ye kaun sa aadmi hai, mujhe bhi milao.
Itne zyada hai ki main kahan se shuru karu. तो रिस्पॉन्स होता है वाओ यू नो अ मैन हैज रिटन सो ब्यूटिफुली अबाउट मैरिज. एक खातून मैरिज के बारे में लिखती हैं एंड इवन इफ शी राइट्स ब्यूटिफुली एंड इंटेलिजेंटली अबाउट इट द रिस्पॉन्स इज हाँ तो ठीक है औरत है शादी के बारे में लिखा है नो बिग डील. व्हाई इज दैट?
Yeah, I don't know.
I personally think because for a long time today we have two female I think HarperCollins, Random House, and are both head by you know managing editors are women, and I think that's changing a lot now. The gatekeepers are open to showcasing women, and I applaud those women. I applaud those women who say that it's okay to have a little bit of fun while you read. And I applaud women who are writing children's fiction in India because there are so that has also been the place of men, especially in India.
But absolutely, but we are also talking about a paucity of information within ourselves. So for example, I am part of something called the International Writing Program at the University of Iowa, and we had these panels. And one of the things that emerged yesterday from that panel discussion was that before all of us felt so self-important that, oh, we went to the IWP, Kuratula and Heather went to the IWP in the 60s. I did not know this, neither did anybody else. Ismat Chugtai, for example, there is a... Who wrote Sultana's Dream? Kya naam tha unka? There was this Bangladeshi khatoon who wrote the first science fiction story in 1906. So these women have existed for a long time. It's just that we have not known about them.
No, absolutely. But I think it's the how many have come through in terms of a proportion.
How many have been represented in the press? Yes. Which is why, again, when Framji first brought up this conversation, my reluctance to engage in it was that we have to separate what we are talking about. Are we talking about the presence of women in fiction?
Yeah.
Because that's a facetious question.
Yeah,
of course we are present. We have been present from the word go. Or are we talking about the public representation of women in fiction?
Or the public response to women in fiction. You know, so I'm writing a collection of short stories. And my family knows about it, so we talk about it. There was a dinner at our house the other day, and this man came along, and he said, so, you know, unke brill cream baal the, aur suit shoot pehna hua tha, to cigarette pee rahe the. So, here you're writing a collection of short stories. What are they about? So I said, what are they about? They are about relationships. They are about love. They are about young men and women coming of age in urban Pakistan, in Manhattan, in London. They are about the different forms desire takes. So I was talking to you, and I said, okay, domesticity stuff. Talk to my wife. It was just like, okay, so you're a man, so this love shove. Interest hi nahi hai aapko. So, nahi, nahi, mere biwi se baat kare, ye aap domesticity stuff, ye unse baat kare.
But so,
there's this sense that love and relationships is the tidy domain of women's writing, which is absurd, you know. Tolstoy wrote very movingly about love and infidelity. There are so many people. But there is this bias that if you're writing a tidy domestic drama, that is the domain of women. And if you're writing about war and technological advancement and these big sprawling subjects, those are more suited to men. And men actually write more about them because they have this bravado and they have this kind of off-the-charts confidence that I will be the cultural interpreter of my age. If you look at the best novelists in America or certainly the most celebrated novelists in the West, you know, their literary merit gives them a place in culture. Right? So not just in the literary world, but they live in these places where the air is rich and they live on Fifth Avenue and they, you know, they become cultural ambassadors almost. Whereas there are very few women, I think, who are able to attain that level of, you know, that position.
Would you say that is different in South Asia? Many of the most celebrated novelists, writers, poets in South Asia are women. Beginning with Rashid Jahan, Ismat Chugtai, Babsi Sidhwa, Kurutalan Heather, Anita Desai, Kiran Desai,
Arundhati Roy,
sure. And the three fantastic writers who are sitting on the stage. So, would you say it's different in South Asia?
Go ahead.
None of us want to handle this question.
I actually don't know. I mean, I think contemporary fiction may, yes. contemporary fiction mein ye jo aapne sare examples diye hain clearly women are celebrated but I still think women have a long way to go. I think women write, when women write about society, they're writing about life, and I think it's not afforded or given the kind of respect that a man is given when he writes about the same issues. That's sort of what I've been saying.
I think a woman's, I'm just going to speak from my perspective, my expectations of my art are lower than the expectations of other male artists that I know who happen to do the thing that I do.
Yes, absolutely.
I think that I'm going to throw something here. I think writing is one of the few professions that are actually fairly, you know, gender, they're not that gender, you know, there's not that much discrimination. But as such, if you talk about many other things in my career, I used to be an investment banker. And luckily in India, some of the biggest bankers are women. And so I think we have, if there's one profession where we've been in for a long time, it's writing. And that goes to show that we are powerful storytellers. So I don't think we are discriminated against from the perspective of being given a voice. I do think that our perception of our writing has to change. So there needs to be the thing with Nora Roberts, perhaps one of the biggest bestsellers in the world. She has written over 147 books. She has sold over 400 million copies. She says she hardly ever gets invited to literary festivals. Whereas her contemporaries, Stephen King, who also writes commercial fiction, will be invited to a literary festival. So that means perception has to change. But I still believe that writing is the best place I can be if I want equal opportunities today. Yeah. And so I'm quite happy.
I'd like to add one thing, which is that I think there's a lot of self-censorship that goes on in the minds and sort of hearts of women as they're writing. I was reading a report recently about how men and women interact and react in a professional setting, say in a meeting. Now, if the boss asks something and the man doesn't know the answer, he's going to raise his hand and a lot of confidence he's going to say something that he has no clue what he's talking about, but for confidence hoga, bakwas karne ka, in a sense. Whereas a woman will think 10 times, have I thought about what I want to say? So that idea again, that I think men have a lot more, I don't know whether confidence is the right word, but the sense that they can get away with a lot more. And it applies to novel writing also, the subjects that they choose.
So in her essay, Virginia Woolf specifically says at the end of that long paragraph that I read, that a woman must have money and a room of her own if she is to write fiction. Can you talk a little bit about the people or the conditions that have given you space to write individually, the ways in which, in fact, money and a room of one's own has been important to you?
I think that when we're talking about Virginia Woolf, we should all remember that at the end of her life, she put stones in her pocket and walked into a river.
Yeah, and drowned herself.
Yes.
So, you know, yes. That's a great line, and that's one of the things that writers share across gender. Great line, yeah. I mean, it might be, you know, in the bigger scheme of things, a completely awful idea, but, you know. I think that the room that you need is not necessarily a physical room. We all need access to a particular space in our heads. And, yeah, and money does have a lot to do with it.
I think money has a lot to do with it. I think that many women and men don't go into writing because they're scared of how are they going to feed themselves. I was exceptionally lucky that I had something put away to help me take to jump, essentially. And because creative writing is really hard when you do it. Any writing is hard. Creative writing is especially hard. Fiction, when you have to do it under pressure, your imagination needs to be calm for if you want it to take flight as such, you know, if you want to imagine all those things. So you do need money. And with regards to a room, I like my physical space. I think it's extremely important. J.K. Rowling, once, and she's one of my top three authors, I love her. She said that it's all right to write in a cafe, but when you get a bit wealthy, you want a room at the Balmoral to finish your final book. And I think, and she says money helps to write better. So, but then again, Oscar Wilde was practically broke.
Also,
right?
She had kids. I have kids. Hi, kids. They're in the audience.
Hi.
Yes.
Hi.
And I think she said, I needed to get away and just find a place to write from all of, you know. So, that's, I think physical space is important.
But also, I think, you know, if you look at some of the best writers of the past, you look at somebody like George Orwell and you look at Graham Greene and even some South Asian writers, money is important, but some of the best writing has come from people who were struggling, actually, who had to tell a story. You know, they didn't have the comfort of a room or a desk or a Mac. But in fact, George Orwell is working in a ratty little cafe in Paris. He had unko tuberculosis bhi ho gaya tha ek waqt pe, but wo napkins pe likhte the because he had a story to tell. And I, in that sense, just to take this a little forward, I think that, you know, the professionalization of creative writing, i.e. creative writing schools, that fetishize the idea of form, i.e. ke agar aap khubsurat sentence likh sakte hain, to aap writer ban sakte hain. This is a very dangerous idea. Khubsurat sentences se kahaniyan nahi banti. Aapki imagination se banti hain aur aapke real life experiences se banti hain. And some of the best writers have written out of adversity, so they didn't have money. Up to, you know, writers are these cultural ambassadors who wear expensive clothes and go to, you know, festivals like this one, and that's actually all they do. And they don't, they often say that we don't have time to write because I'm hopping from one festival in Paris to another festival in New York to Delhi to Fulan to Fulan. And you actually need this desperation to write. J.K. Rowling was dirt poor.
Yeah,
I'm sure all
exactly.
of you know this.
Yeah.
So this idea that you need a ton of money to write, I'm not sure about that. I think you need to have a story to tell. I lived and worked in New York for 3 years, and I had a good job. I worked as an editor at the Wall Street Journal. I went there after college. And one day I called up my father, who's also a writer, he's a journalist, and I said, you know, I want to move back to Pakistan. And he said, kya? Pagal ho gayi ho? To Wall Street Journal ke liye kaam karti ho, Pakistan aana chahti ho? I said, ji abbu, wo kehte hain kyun, kya hua hai? I said, wo bas dil nahi lag raha, ghar yaad aata hai aur kitab likhni hai aur yahan rehke goron ke saath bas dil nahi lag raha, I want to come home. So he said, acha, soch lo. Anyway, I came home 6 months later, I quit my job, and it's the best decision I made because I don't know if you know, but I act also. Ek do drama, 5-6 drama kiye hain TV ke liye. And just interacting with fellow Pakistanis, you know, who work hard, who have real lives, that has done wonders for my fiction. When I was living in Manhattan, I was writing these slightly deadened and dull stories about relationships, right? Ever since I moved back, there's this, been this energy and life in my stories, and I think that's entirely because I live in Pakistan. And because there's jahan adversity hoti hai, jahan mushkilat hoti hai, wahan kahaniyan banti hai. Aap Russia 19th century mein dekh lein, Tolstoy, Dostoevsky, you know, it's dark stuff, but it's great, lasting, beautiful stuff. So Pakistan, in that sense, is a storyteller's, I mean, dream nahi kahungi because that sounds a bit ajeeb, but it's a great place for a writer to be. And I'm very grateful that I'm here and writing.
Follow that up with a question. If you're saying that the best stories emerge from conditions of conflict or conditions of difficulty, then to translate that perhaps to Sherazade and the act of telling a story when your life is literally on the line, does the way in which that conflict is represented, talked about, told, is it different in the way women tell it than men tell it? Is women's fiction perhaps more complex in its understanding of those kinds of issues?
You know, I think that your question, actually, I agree with you completely, Meera. I understand where you're coming from. This is a storyteller's paradise. But as a Pakistani woman who happens to be a storyteller, I have to say, one of the benefits of being a Pakistani storyteller and a woman is that patriarchy works for me, which is where, you know, Sherazade is relevant to this conversation.
Maine Sherazade nahi padhi bhi, so I can't comment.
But this is basically a woman who's singing for her supper, yeah, right? To one man who is her reader and her ultimate audience. And I think as female storytellers, often we do what we do because of the support of the men in our lives, mm-hmm, whether they happen to be our father,
yes,
or our husband,
yes,
or our sons.
Yeah.
And it would be disingenuous of us to not admit that.
Absolutely, yeah, absolutely.
I think so. I mean, but I wanted to add, for people who, the pressure also for writers like me, especially travel writers, the deadline, that's the, you know, the proverbial cut to the neck. But yes, and I don't think that, especially in India, where we have a lot of female storytellers, so again, you... But if you say that all fiction comes from darkness and adversity, then what do you do when you don't have, when you don't have, when you have don't have darkness and adversity? When you're a teenager, you have hormones raging, which is why some of what you think is your best, but essentially is the worst poetry you write, is when you're a teenager. And I look back at that and I say, oh my God. What was I writing? What was I thinking? And my next book is a young adult novel, and I'm actually going back to those poems and saying, I need inspiration. It does come from darkness, but I think we need to understand that it's still fiction, and what do you do when you move forward? Because it is a job. It isn't, you know, I do have to sit at my desk for 3 to 4 hours a day, and I have to get a book out. So do all writers, especially commercial writers. And it has to come from somewhere else. And I could be extremely pleased with myself that day, and I have to dig deep. So, yeah.
I just completely agree with what they're saying. Would just like to add that actually writing is a very lonely thing. Abhi jab main yahan bahar phir rahi thi, a lot of young women and men were coming up to me and saying ki main aapke mazmoon padha, ye hua, main bhi likhna chahta hu, main bhi likhna chahti hu, to zara guide kare.
Ye line hoti hai, by the way.
Kuch chote chote pyare pyare bacche bhi the. So those of you who want to be writers, I mean, I often say, you know, when you're acting, you have a makeup artist, you have a director, you have an editor, you have co-stars. Sare khade hote hain, agar aap kahin kharab kar dein ya line bhul jaye, there are other people to help you, right? To make you look good, to help you emote for the screen, etc. But when you're writing, until you have an editor, you're entirely on your own. And so I think you have to have this burning desire to be a writer and to have a story to tell if you really want to do this, because it's a very lonely thing. And it's an inward-looking thing, and it's a solitary thing. I think Yeats, W.B. Yeats, the Irish poet, said, writing is the social act of a solitary man. It's how you engage with the world. But when you're doing it at your desk, it's really difficult.
Last year, when we were judging the KLF Embassy of France Prize, Muniza Shamsi said something that has actually sat with me now for over a year. And it was part of the conversation we were having about the three shortlisted novels that we were considering for the prize. And the shortlisted novels were Uzma Aslam Khan's Thinner Than Skin, Mohsen Hamid's How to Get Filthy Rich in Rising Asia, and Nadeem Aslam's Blind Man's Garden. And Muniza said something which has sat with me in strange ways for a year. So I've already asked them this question, but I will ask them again. She said that, you know, one of the things about women's fiction, that women's fiction tends not to get recognized because it is quieter. By which I think she meant more reflective, more meditative than men's fiction. I'm not sure I entirely agree with that, but...
Well, first I would like to correct your use of various terms. It's fiction written by women and not women's fiction.
Yes.
I didn't understand the rest of the question.
That the novels that women write are perhaps more meditative, more reflective, quieter than the novels that men write.
Did she mention a specific novel that she was talking about?
We were talking about the three that I mentioned. But she said it in a more general frame.
So like Jhumpa Lahiri's novels about immigrant life, they're pretty quiet.
I mean, look, I'm a woman, and I know other women. I don't think we are any quieter or meditative or peaceful or less sexual than our male counterparts. So I don't, you know.
I think we, I think I wrote back to Dr. Framji and I said we are not quiet people. But I think there is a use of self-censorship.
Yeah.
So self-censorship means like Dipti Kapoor, who's come out with a great book called A Bad Character, she said something in the Jaipur Lit Fest, and she's one of the first women to openly write a book, an erotic novel. and she said that we do a lot of self-censorship, and therefore, how much profanity can we use? How much, and does that make it any louder? Does that make it any more convincing? Does that make it any more literary? But I think that women's fiction, if you look at Sylvia Plath, she was not quiet. In no way was she quiet. She was extremely loud, a bit suicidal, and I would not recommend reading her when you're a teenager. But, you know, no, don't do that. Read Maya Angelou. I don't think it's quiet, and I think it's getting less quiet, but there, as long as we step away from self-censorship, we'll be okay.
Yeah, I agree. I think. मैं ये शुरू से यही बात कर रही हूँ बार-बार कि if a man writes about marriage in an interesting way, you know, he gets a lot of praise for it. Jeffrey Eugenides wrote, what was his book called? The Marriage something or the other. It had a wedding ring on it. Anyway, thank you. And it, on the cover, it had a ring on it, and it got a lot of praise because people said, "Wow, a man wrote so sensitively and so remarkably about marriage." I think if a woman writes a very, very big novel about domestic strife and love and relationships in a kind of freely associative way, with some recipes thrown in, she'll be considered self-indulgent. People will say, "Oh, she's writing about stuff she already knows about." Whereas if a man writes about the same issues, people will just raise their hands in applause and say, "Kamal kar diya yaar. Look, a man has written about, you know, a relationship, or beech mein thodi cooking recipes bhi dalni hai."
Achha, but at this point, I want to. I think you're spot on. But look at sales. So, for example, E.L. James wrote this book, yes, called 50 Shades of Grey. J.K. Yeah. Rowling wrote Harry Potter. So, regardless of the critical response to that, that actually translated into sales.
Yeah.
So it doesn't matter really at the end of the day. This is all just hogwash that people,
exactly,
you know, exchange. But sales tell the real story, and the real story is it doesn't matter what you write about, it's what you sell. And women have been selling more than men in recent years.
Is that Nora Roberts, J.K. Rowling.
Yeah, the sales figures for
Colleen
women
McCullough.
Writers.
Colleen McCullough was one of the biggest bestsellers of all time. She wrote The Thorn Words, and sadly died, rest in peace. But she was one of the, they weren't quiet. And I think quietness comes in sales because they got their word across significantly all over the world and everyone knows them. Of course, E.L. James, we have a whole different.
Yeah, so what are we talking about? Critical acclaim or actual sales?
Both.
Agreed.
So it seems to be that what the three of you are suggesting is that, in fact, women writers of fiction have actually turned a corner, that there is, in fact, significantly more space today than there was in perhaps previous generations, especially in South Asia. There are women are certainly more, what you're suggesting, that 70% of women are or the readers for fiction.
Right.
But at the same time, that the media coverage of it or the representation of it in the press hasn't quite caught up to these things, and that
I'd just like to speak to this as a Pakistani woman. I don't, you know, as a writer, I'm a writer. I'm not a Muslim writer. I'm not a Pakistani writer. I'm just a writer. I'm not a female writer. But, you know, meri khwahish hai ki meri kitab Pakistan mein padhi jaye. More than anything else, you know, I want my fellow Pakistanis to read my book when it comes out, because that will give me an immense amount of happiness. But I have to say, in the environment in which we live, you know, certain issues are increasingly becoming taboo. And religion, for example, there are certain very, very clearly drawn red lines. And to cross those red lines is to invite all sorts of charges.
Yes,
or
yes, but with regards to crossing those lines, I think, especially in India, you can cross those lines if you're a man or a woman, and you could still get banned.
Oh, I don't mean as a woman.
You know,
I'm saying as a writer.
As a writer.
So just as a writer,
yeah,
crossing
because
those
Perumal
lines.
Murugan, I don't know. He was banned because of Perumal Murugan.
Okay.
It was a book that was in India that was banned 3 weeks ago, and we're all very angry about it because he supposedly crossed some lines. It's a fiction. It's a product of fiction, and I think, now going back to the question you asked, I think we need to stop talking about women and fiction. We need to say, we should try and get the name away. I mean, J.K. Rowling refused to put her name. Her name is Joanne. The publishers told her, don't do Joanne because it won't sell. The little boys, the 10-year-old boys will not buy your book.
Yeah.
P.D. James, her first name, she had to change her name. Her name wasn't P.D. James. She changed it to P.D. James so that she could sell more you know, more crime, and her books will be read all over the world. So I think we need to take that out. We can't all change, become pseudonyms. That's just wrong.
Rishma, so just going back to Framji's original question, you know, the Pakistan in which we currently live is a place where there are too many wackos roaming around, even for the airing of an uncontroversial opinion. That is what makes me fearful, and that is what makes me sad. Because anyone can pick up a gun and shoot you if they don't like what you've written, if it offends their sensibilities, their religious or cultural sensibilities. And I like to think that I'm not scared by this, or I don't think about this, but I think I do. And I think this is also a form of self-censorship that, as a Pakistani woman, I feel very, very strongly about, and it makes me deeply sad, but I don't think there's any way around it. You have some form of protection when you're writing in English, because the people issuing fatwas are not likely to read a 500-page novel in English by a woman. Who knows, though, these days, pata nahi, shayad padhte bhi hain. But ye ek environment hai jisme hum likh rahe hain, aur khauf ki environment hai. To ye sochti hu main iske bare mein. I don't know if Shandana, you agree?
There is no polite answer to that question, so I'm just going to be quiet.
Okay.
Did you censor yourself when you were writing Survival Tips for Lunatics?
No, I've never censored myself. I think as a writer, I should not. Whether I find distribution for my opinions or my art is a different matter. But as an artist, I do not censor myself.
Okay. Did you?
Well, my first novel was, it's not a serious matter, it's a love story, it's travel. There was no need for censorship. The physical nature of some of the scenes, I wrote as much as I wanted to write, and I was quite happy. However, with the work I'm going to do, which has nothing to do with religion, there are elements of potential, there are problems with that, and I'm going to make my publisher deal with it.
Lucky you.
No, but Perumal, I'm sorry I'm repeating this, but Perumal Murugan did go through what you're, you know, what you're worrying about, and which was a shock to us, which shouldn't have happened. And so obviously in India we obviously have a problem.
Writers like Ismet Chughtai clearly did not censor themselves, and were got in trouble with the law. There was a court case over the short story The Quilt, Lehaf. And do you think those issues are behind us now?
Not at all.
No, but when that happened, Manto was also, charged 6 times. And apparently in Ismet's own memoirs, the judge called her into his chambers and said, I think you're a really good writer. This Manto guy, on the other hand. Yeah, I think that as women, actually, like I said earlier, we get away with a lot of things. Not necessarily artistically, but, you know, for example, when we go to pay our bijli bills, we have a separate line. If you care to use it, I don't. But, we'll give you to know. Okay. Ladies, hain, jayen.
Nahin,
but, no, I'm being facetious. I'm Meera. I know you're, I'm not actually, I do not think that we live in a paradise in any way. But I think that the issues that affect us right now affect all of us equally across gender and class, which is why I do not wish to explore that further.
I don't, see, so I'm writing, one of my stories is about a relationship between a man and a woman, and it's one of my bolder pieces. And there are a lot of physical descriptions of their physical relationship. Now, when I'm writing, sitting down to write a certain scene where there's, it's a romantic scene, I honestly, I have to be honest, I think, yaar, ye itna zyada intense ho gaya, isko zara tone down karo. You know, I this is just how it is. Maybe it's because I live and work here, I live in this place where maybe TV is very conservative. I'm not a conservative person, but I know the kinds of people who are going to read it. Ek to my nani nana will read it, so it's like, oh God, kya kahenge, padh ke, dekh ke. But beyond that, I think that there is self-censorship, and I think we have to struggle. I think women have to struggle very hard to fight against it. I think if a man was sitting down to write the kind of scenes that I'm writing these days, I wonder if he would be agonized the way I'm occasionally agonized about being so open, trying to say certain things. I really wonder about that in English.
Okay. In relation to self-censorship, in relation to, I know you're resisting Shandana talking about women and fiction, would you say that issues related to patriarchal societies, male dominance, male authority, do not get addressed by men as much in fiction, perhaps, in the South Asian context than it does?
I think that this is not in my job description as a writer.
Yes,
I think that,
I
come from the point where I tell a story, and it's a visceral, organic process. So I don't come from the opposite end where I have to deconstruct everything intellectually and then see if it makes sense. I mean, the point of art is to explain yourself to yourself, not to anybody else. So
I agree. I don't think of anyone else, and especially when I'm writing now, I don't think of anyone else when I'm writing. I do have to say that when I was writing my scene in my book, I was so worried about my father-in-law. What would he say? And I'm hoping, I actually folded the page and I said, it's okay, I'm going to write this. But I've told him, I said, if you don't want to think badly of me, just don't read that page. But he did. And you know what? He turned around to me and says, Bitya, it was so good. It was fine, you know? Don't worry about it. Go write more. But going back to that, if you worry too much about what's on the other side, if you worry too much about the points you want to make about patriarchal society, I'm very angry about some things, but I can't bring that into my work because I don't think it'll be authentic. Because there's something I want to say, there's a story I want to tell, and I want to make you have fun. And absolutely. I want to make you laugh, and I want to transport you somewhere that's magical, where there are fairies and elves and little sausages walk around, and that's not going to happen if I'm talking about a matriarchal and a patriarchal society.
Yeah, I totally agree. You know, I'm writing this book so that I can entertain you and so that you can be part of my world or the larger world and read this and say, oh yeah, you know, I went through this also, cool. If I wanted to write about really meaty issues like patriarchy, which of course you can write in an interesting way in a novel also, but my short stories are not dealing with that. If I wanted to deal with that, I would write a pamphlet. I would do some political journalism, which I do. But my fiction is quiet stories.
Fair enough. I think we can open it up for questions. Do we have a mic?
ये सवाल है यस यस
इधर भी थे साहब
नहीं सर
वी कैन हियर यू वैसे
We can hear you.
Nadia, ask the question, I'll repeat it.
Well, the question is, well, it's not just a question. First of all, the novel I do have a question, but I just need to clarify that. The first novel was Gurney Glapayet's French novel, written about 100 years earlier.
तीसरी विवाद के देखना है कि हम नजर ये थी कि मौलवी साहब अपने घर को अपना घर समझते हैं क्योंकि दूसरे का दौरा खाना नहीं लाते
How do rank, class, and connection factor into the way in which women's writing survives over time?
For me, it's a factor because I am married to a very nice man who will pay the bills while I sit on my posterior and stare at a wall.
High five.
I have the privilege
of doing
that.
High five.
High five.
High five.
Yeah. To our husbands.
So that's two of us. I don't know.
Meena?
Yeah, I think, by the way, European novel ki baat kari thi, wo dimaag se nikal gaya. I think it's very, very important. It's, you know, the two main men in my life, my father and my brother. My brother's written a novel also, and so there's this great atmosphere of support in the house. A lot of criticism also, because sare writers hain, sara. But of course, comfort and privilege, these things are incredibly important at the end of the day. Yeah.
Right there, in the front row.
चल रहा है नीचे. हाँ तो बहुत ही थैंक यू, बहुत ही इंटरेस्टिंग पैनल था. माय क्वेश्चन इज टू ऑल ऑफ यू बट मेनली सम ऑफ द थिंग्स दैट यू सेड इज मायरा मीरा
जी मीरा
इदराला की गोछा करते जाते और कहने जाते
सर आप दरवाजा बंद कर सकते हैं क्या पीछे.
ये अटैच्ड है ना तो कैसे लेके जाओगी. आप अपना क्वेश्चन कह दें वो दोहरा देंगे. अच्छा नहीं बैशिंग तो नहीं थी. इट वॉज मोर अ कॉमेंट ऑन सॉर्ट ऑफ द नेचर ऑफ पब्लिशिंग एंड द नेचर ऑफ दिस वेरी फाइनेंशियल वर्ल्ड इन विच बुक पब्लिशिंग नाउ ऑपरेट्स राइट. सो द सेल्फ सेंसरशिप दैट आई वॉज टॉकिंग अबाउट यू नो वुमेन ऑल्सो लुक एट सेल्स, वुमेन लुक एट द थिंग्स दैट द एजेंट्स आर इंटरेस्टेड इन, द थिंग्स दैट पब्लिशर्स वॉन्ट टू राइट. नाउ आई नो दैट यू नो इन अमेरिका दे से हनी यू शुड स्टिक टू लाइक लव बिकॉज़ यू राइट अबाउट लव रियली वेल, सो जस्ट लाइक स्टिक टू दैट. ये होता है हर जगह होता है. सो इट वॉजन्ट एट ऑल मेल बैशिंग, इट वॉज अ कॉमेंट ऑन द काइंड ऑफ कल्चर दैट वी ऑल लिव इन एंड इट्स अ कल्चर दैट स्टिल एंड आई विल से दिस विद कॉन्फिडेंस प्रिविलेजेस the male voice and the male point of view.
We second her. Oh, well, I second her on the male voice and the male point of view.
So. I second you and I second you. I think you're both right and I think that's possible.
Yes.
Question?
Yes, Hamza. Somebody did mention cookie recipes. We will get to that shortly.
There's a lady there, behind.
A lady over there.
My question is about coming into the career or so to speak of writing. Like from the world I come from, if I tell that main writing mein ja rahi hu, they'll be really encouraging and be like ha ha chalo kar lo ghar pe to baith ke karna hai. But like if I go into say investment banking, there will be eyebrows raised. So how empowering is that sort of career to this in sense of our society, because for women it's easier to go into writing in the world where I live in.
So. Can I take this? Mm-hmm. Okay. So it's actually, it was the other way around for me. I was in investment banking for 10 years. My family was exceptionally proud of me. And I think the day somebody found out I was making a certain lakh salary, it came close to having a notice board put up in my school. So there was a lot of pride that Reshma Krishnan has become an investment banker in Bombay. So when I did take up writing, there was a lot of disappointment. There was like, oh my God, you're a writer now. Kya karegi tu? Ghar pe baithegi tu? And in Tamil, we say, enna panna pora ni? Enna panna pora? Veetla pora? So are you going to sit at home? Who's going to pay your bills? Because my husband had also quit at the time, so they thought we were going to be in penury, like sweep and all sorts of things. So there was disappointment. There was disappointment because they didn't think it was empowering enough, that I wasn't setting a right example. So it was the complete opposite. But do whatever you want to do.
More questions? There, in the middle there.
And the comment is that in this fabulous Karachi Literature Festival for 3 days, it's a comment about self-censorship that no one has mentioned the winner of the Nobel Peace Prize from Pakistan, Magaga Yousafzai. so it's an example that was self-censorship that she was not invited here because the festival would have been closed down. Secondly,
Sorry, are you talking about Dr. Abdus Salam?
No, I'm talking about
Malala Yousafzai.
Malala Yousafzai.
You would like us to mention Malala Yousafzai?
No, not Malala Yousafzai. I think ordinarily, with all these celebrities and personalities that have been invited here on Pakistani subjects and political subjects, it's very important to note that the festival organizers, because of self-censorship, did not invite.
Maybe she might not have. Sorry, she might not have been available.
And I understand where you're coming from. But as a writer, I often feel like at festivals like this, particularly in Karachi, there's too much politics. Can we not just talk about the written word? Sorry, was that rude? Is that self-censorship right now?
No. That was the opposite of self-censorship.
Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. I asked the questions that what is the role of intellectuals in today's society? What is going in Pakistan? They doesn't criticize the policies and other things. Is that their job is just to write stories and take the perks and privileges and move here and there? Is that your job? Like you take the example of Habib Jalib. He was intellectual. What does he think? And nowadays you people are just moving here and there and abroad and moving. Taking the perks and privileges. And my second question is that why today the intellectuals join politics?
What is the reason behind that? They don't or they do? Nahi karte ya karte hai?
They do politics. What is the reason? It is not their job.
I'd like to take
their job is to just give the nation a direction. They should stand and tell the people that that is the right and that is the wrong, like the Irfan Siddiqui, and I do not take the name of some other intellectuals who joined politics and famous for the, I do not want to say, the Mira City is sitting here. Thank you.
I think that the characterization of intellectuals in both questions is a little simple. I think that intellectuals are ordinary people. They are people like any of you sitting out in the audience, and as people who live in a particular country, a particular geographical space, afflicted by any number of issues, tackling or being challenged by any number of issues, we all have exactly the same responsibility, I think. I don't think intellectuals are in any way special people who have to be at the vanguard of these things. And I think that to say that intellectuals should not be part of a political conversation or to be politicians themselves is to actually think of politics in a very small way. I think that politics is, everything we do is political. The moment you walk out of your front door, you get in your car, you drive out of your gate, you drive down the road, you take a rickshaw, you take a bus, it's political. So I don't think that anything we do can be removed from the politics that we engage in every day. So intellectuals do that as do everybody else. There's a question in the back there.
My name is Saira, and I want to ask that every woman in our society has a story of her own to tell. But we don't have institutions here that everybody has to travel the same road which you people have traveled. We have to make the same struggles. Why don't those who have achieved something, why don't you people provide us with some institution where we can find mentors and they can guide us for being a woman and write and fiction and everything?
Well, I think that's precisely what we're doing, the fact that we're up here talking to people, because writers actually tend to be, I'm going to speak for you ladies, misfits and loners, and it's traumatic for us to be in these situations. But we are here precisely for those reasons, because we want other people to know that, listen, other people, we did this, you can do this too. There's no institution you have to go through to be a writer. I dropped out of college, I was a duffer in school. I don't think going to school or getting good grades helps you. Also, in the last 2 weeks, I have taken Indian writers to the writing school where they had a classroom of 30 Pathan girls
and 30 Pathan boys, which was segregated. Then they went to Sindh Madrasatul Islamia University. Then they went to Habib University. And all this was made possible through the KLF, the IWP, and the US Embassy in Karachi. So a better question is, why will Pakistani society not support its arts? Why do we have to turn to others for support?
Well said. Well said, I completely agree. I mean, I think once my book comes out, I'd like to teach. But beyond that, what can I do?
Question?
Are you through with your answer, right? Yeah. First of all, I want to compliment all these three beautiful women sitting here. Amazing stuff. One is talking about a travelogue, the other is talking about exotic stories to tell, and the other is talking about fiction written by a woman. My compliments to all three of you. By profession, I'm an engineer too, and I'm also trying to write, so I can relate to what you were saying, and I've been traveling around the world to find out a platform to raise things that are bothering me too much living in the same society. I'm sure if one day I'm going to publish something, it's going to be too bold, and I'm ready for that. So I think we should not be criticizing the fact that we should say and tell to censor the stuff that we are writing. We should be bold enough to project our ideologies as writer. And I think the concept of being a male writer or a female writer should not exist. Writers are writers and they should be admired as writers. So compliments to all three of you.
I totally agree with what the young lady said, but I just like to compliment the man sitting right next to them because Dr. Framji has done a lot of great work. I'm not saying this just because he's a guy and it's just one guy on the stage. That's just beside the point. My question is that you mentioned about self-censorship, and I believe it really is a crime that in Pakistan the voices of writers and speakers are being silenced. But I think I felt that in the last couple of years, you know, as I've grown up, what I'm seeing is that the voices are actually raising further and further. The more, you know, we see an event of a voice being silenced, if one voice is silenced, 100 other voices come up. And I hope that continues to be the case.
Inshallah.
But my question is that you mentioned about self-censorship, and it really is a crime that a writer in Pakistan, you know, has to think about what the consequences of his or her book will be when it comes out. And it's a shame. But my question really is, if you were, for example, writing and describing the same scenes sitting in Manhattan, for example, are you sure that you would be, you know, you would feel completely free about writing whatever you want to, or would you still feel a sense of self-censorship even, you know, apart from Pakistan?
I think bahut kam, because there's this physical immunity. Ab aap dekh le, Malala Yousafzai Birmingham ki safety mein reh ke kitabe padhti hai. Ye soche aap. Idhar wo bachi kitab nahi pad sakti thi. She was shot in the face for wanting to read a book. So, and then the way she was vilified here, just for wanting to go to school. So, this is the environment in which we are living. Bahut achhi cheeze bhi ho rahi hain. Mohammad Jibran Nasir jaise log bhi hain jo khade ho rahe hain, aur you know, movements log chala rahe hain. Aadmi ka maine ji zikr kiya aapke liye. Lekin bilkul self censorship hoti hai. Ek Bangladeshi writer hai, what was it, Tasneem Anas?
I mean,
so she had to flee, because the Jamaat-e-Islami didn't like what she wrote. And given in the environment in which we live, kal ko hum kisi ke saath bhi ye ho sakta hai. So you worry about your life. Like I said, there are too many crazy people roaming around, even for the airing of an uncontroversial opinion.
Yeah, and just to add to that, and you know this, this is one of my students, so thank you for the compliment, but Hassan, I really don't need it. But even, and this is not just a question about writing, this is a question in really all areas of our lives. I mean, when I'm sitting in the classroom and I teach things, there are things that I teach when I'm teaching in the US that I would not in a million years teach here. I just would not do it because it would be a stupid thing for me to do. So yeah, self-censorship exists, yes, and more so here than in other places.
Thank you so much.
Because the mic was grabbed. I just wanted to say, I was trying to touch the same point, which is even at a festival, there's some subjects which are just too sensitive and too hard to be discussed. The second example is of Charlie Hebdo. Nobody has even mentioned that here because it's just too sensitive. So it's just a comment, and you don't have to be so defensive immediately. It was just a comment.
Sir, I wasn't being defensive, I was being aggressive.
Thank you. Yeah. Yeah. I think we're done. That is the last question. Thank you very much to these lovely women.